A frank exchange of views now on BBC Two as Michael Burke and guests explore the moral maze.
According to the Prime Minister, no less, we're living in a job culture. It must have been a very simple and effective politics to declare war on all the granny muggers, the lager guzzlers, the car vandalisers. But it's not turned out that way. It's not that we don't all recognise that there's a problem, it's just that we can't agree who or what's to blame for creating jobs, what we should do about them, or even who the real jobs are. That's our moral maze tonight. The programme today is Independent described as the highest form of the new jobbery. Presumably a reference to our panel, Janet Daly of The Times, David Cook of Green College, Oxford, Edward Pearce of The Guardian and Dr David Starkey of the LSE. Janet, do you see yourself as an upmarket job?
No, can't say that.
A downmarket
certainly
job.
Not upmarket. Certainly not upmarket.
Seriously,
if youth, particularly male youth, is out of control, then it's because as a society, which is to say as parents and teachers and the criminal justice system itself, we've taken a conscious decision not to control it. There's nothing abnormal about destructive or aggressive behaviour in young males. They don't have to be pathological cases to behave antisocially. They just have to be unrestrained and morally untutored. An adult society that condemns all moral instruction as authoritarian is abdicating its responsibility to the immature, and we can see the consequences of that all around us.
Very polished paper. David?
Well, there's a very simple biblical principle that what people sow, they reap. If I put in carrots, then I don't get turnips. If I smoke 40 cigarettes a day and drink 3 bottles of whiskey a day, inevitably my body will be harmed. In a society which, for example, didn't think grammar or punctuation mattered, we have an illiterate generation. I think we're back really to the nature-nurture debate. When we're talking about job culture, is it because of human nature or because of social and economic pressures? I think the answer is a both and, not an either or. But what I want to hear from the panelists is how do we control human nature without destroying the individual or destroying society?
Edward.
Well, the irony is that it was actually rather bad politics. The Prime Minister had no sooner spoken than the tinkling folk, the likes of us, beat him about the head with our cocktail glasses and said how naff and unsmart it was. Actually, it's absolutely true. There is a hell of a crisis. The question is, what do you do about it? And I am caught betwixt two fires. I want to be against all the people who sort of enjoy the notion of punitive action, flogging and the rest of it, and at the same time be against the people who say it's only children, wrong is a relative word, punishment is wrong, locking people up is wrong. I'm a sort of moderate locker-up, that's where I stand.
mildly against both sides, perhaps.
Well, mildly as I ever am anything. You know me, a savage moderate.
David Starkey.
I think the real problem is, as has been revealed, none of my fellow panellists know anything about history. Historically, Britain is an extremely violent culture in the Middle Ages and right through to the early 19th century. In other words, the period that we have just bade farewell to, between 1880 and 1960, when there were very high levels of public order, is the exception. All we're doing is going back to what was the norm. The reason that there was an exception was very high levels of employment on the one hand and a whole series of very constricting social forms on the other, like trades unions, like state education, like voluntary organisations, like the whole social pressures of the BBC. They have broken up, in some ways, being a very good thing.
I thought that's what I should do, David.
What we have to, but without, as it were, the background of knowledge that would have made your remarks serious. What we've got to understand.
I don't want to stop you too much at the beginning
but
of the programme.
May I just...
Telling you to shut up at the beginning of the programme seems to be a bit
establishes
much...
a record of ill manners even for
it's
you as a chairman.
It's called a preemptive strike.
But can I just say what we've got to realise is that the breaking up of those structures is part of a new freedom, and that we may have to recognise that very high levels of criminality are a price for freedom, which is why America is a society that is crime-ridden, and society and Singapore a society which is largely crime-free.
You clearly don't understand
David, thanks
the distinction between freedom and anarchy.
Our first witness is Dr. Roslyn Miles, who's author of the book The Children We Deserve, a former magistrate in Coventry and a consultant for Cosmopolitan, a position that sounds pregnant with possibilities, if I may say so. Can we agree on, first of all, and briefly on a definition of what a yob is? I mean, is he a drunken, unemployed, working-class male who slashes time?
Well, I'm always suspicious of the British public in one of its periodic fits of morality, and in particular when it seems so clearly created to fill a political vacuum by a Prime Minister whose own language shows he's not unacquainted with some of the yob elements we deprecate. But there is a concern, and I think we'll share it. What I think is the difficulty is targeting some sections of our society and leaving out others.
So picking on the working class in this particular sense.
Picking on the working class. Anybody who's been to Oxford or Cambridge and seen the rugger buggers in full cry after a win, or worse still, the boat club after a bump supper, knows that yobbery is not confined to the lower orders.
But how violent and lawless a society do you think we have? I mean, you were a magistrate in Coventry. Was that a violent and lawless city from that perspective?
Any city is violent and lawless to an extent. And if you do sit as a magistrate and see the constant flow, you are inclined to feel that there is nothing else. But there are many, many young people and older people who have never committed a crime in their lives and never will. I'm just reluctant to get into this labelling.
Yeah, but for those that do commit these sort of crimes or antisocial behaviour of this kind, what, very briefly, do you think is the answer? Do you think more discipline or more understanding or both?
More discipline is the old chestnut. I think by the time they've got to that age, it's probably too late. We don't understand how often the young men who are going around bashing old ladies have already been bashed. I think we need to begin at the very beginning. And I also think we should address it as a problem of maleness, because yob is only boy spelt backwards, as we all know.
Oh, thanks very much. Janet, your witness.
I agree that it's very much a problem of maleness. Would you agree...
You would, Janet.
That, yes. Would you agree that amoral and even vicious impulses are quite a normal part of young male behaviour and have always been, and that it's our responsibility as parents and as teachers and as civil authorities, whatever, to contain those impulses until children have learnt to control them for themselves?
I don't believe that any human being is born intrinsically evil.
No,
I regard
quite
this
so, but that's not quite what I said.
I also do not feel that the way with a child is necessarily to contain it. I believe in education educare. I believe there is goodness there. I believe
course,
there should be structures.
The capacity for goodness, no one is doubting. The question is there a capacity also for viciousness or sadism?
There
or
is
immorality?
That capacity in all of us,
Absolutely.
Not just in the young male. And Absolutely. Certainly I think there are certain social elements which will draw it out more strongly at certain historical right. periods. We are in a grab it and run society, but which is led by some of the leaders and most prominent people of our community.
But can
I won't name names.
Can I put it to you that young males are more in need, if anything, of structure, discipline, and a confidence in adult authority, which has been systematically undermined by a great many sort of fashionable psychological and sociological theories of the last 30 years?
I do believe that males are the weaker sex and they need a great deal more help than they're getting from us in growing up.
Can I just pick you up on one point? You think that there is no intrinsic evil in new human beings?
I do not believe a newborn baby is born evil. I think the doctrine of original sin was one of the most pernicious things ever inflicted on a suffering
humanity.
I also feel very strongly that we have to look at each child as a blank slate. We are in the infancy of our understanding of what the child's genetic inheritance
sure.
may be, or what the hereditary traits
but
will come
surely
out.
Surely the essence of the human condition is that we have a capacity for evil and for good. What you seem to be suggesting is that the child is born innocent and is corrupted by repressive social institutions or whatever. What I'm suggesting to you is perhaps the opposite. That is,
I
those
think
structures...
it's born innocent in the sense of the old sense of ignorant. It knows nothing. It has the
sure.
capacity for everything.
If the
and
slate
I certainly
is
would
blank,
accept
wouldn't it
that.
Be a good thing if they could learn to write on it?
I think they should learn to recite David Shakespeare. I'm with the people who believe they ought to learn poetry by heart, as we all have to do.
Before we get into that, David Cook,
my wife's a head teacher. She has parents bringing a five-year-old, saying, we can't control the five-year-old at home. We hope the school will do that. children can be incredibly evil, incredibly unkind. Surely you recognise that?
I do, but the people who've had that child for 5 years must bear some responsibility for what's happened to that child. Oh, sure. 5 years is an extraordinary long time in a child's life. And I think that's appalling that people can take that attitude. I sympathise entirely with schools who are asked to do the dirty work that parents are abdicating the responsibility
for. So what are we going to do with parents then? Are we going to say to them, you can't have children unless you pass a model test? Unless you fulfil our standards of right and wrong?
Now, you know that's not the case.
Well, I'm asking what we're to do in that situation, because you've condemned the parents. Mm. You're saying it's not fair to leave it to the school. All right, I accept that. What are we then going to do with the parents?
What are we going to do with the parents of the five-year-old or the ones who are coming up now?
The ones who are coming up now. What are we
to do? I have advocated very strongly in my book that people should have parenthood classes. Parenting was always taken as an instinctual function. Look what's happened to it. It is not instinctual. It has never been more complex. It has never been more difficult. And parents have never been more unsupported. If we don't support the mothers and expect them to work full-time and run a home, if we don't support the fathers and continue to deny them parental leave even to get to know their children, if we don't put any money into education, what can we expect?
Right, David Starkey.
Indeed, but what can we expect from something else that you said? I always regard myself as a kind of crossbencher in the sex war that we've been talking about. But this attack on maleness, this attack on maleness is rather interesting. What are you recommending, not so much sterilisation or castration?
Dr. Starkey, it's interesting you hear it as an attack. I meant it as a compliment. I'm suggesting that the gentlemen of the weaker sex need a lot more attention and care in general.
Your charm is charming. I'm asking you to go a little beyond this ineffable charm and tell us what you're really saying. What is supposed to happen to those male qualities of violence, of occasionally very vigorous physical activity, which is sometimes sport, sometimes work? Are we going to try to eliminate them, as was done with the new man, or are we going to try, I think, much more fruitfully, to redirect them? What are you recommending?
I don't believe that maleness and violence are inherently connected. I believe masculinity is predicated on violence, but I believe masculinity is a learned skill. And we have to kick our little boys around horribly to make them into the macho, vile things that they turn into.
So you think naturally all men will be like me, sort of charming crossbenchers in the sex war, do you? So are you recommending a kind of national course for homosexuality? I'm being really serious. I do not understand what you're saying.
Given half a chance, most men don't want to do all that macho rubbish, as so appropriately defined by Norman Mailer.
Edward Rosalind, in the
definition of... Can I finish?
You are very, very shallow.
Edward Rosalind, in the
If you can't do any better than insults, then you might as well at least listen.
I'm being a man, yes.
I am trying to finish my point, which is masculinity and maleness, as defined by Norman Mailer, consists of fighting, fornicating, and making a lot of money. And those two things are still the formula that a lot of our young males are brought up to believe is the only way to live as a man. They have to teach boys to be violent in schools. That's why they make them do all this rugby
stuff. As you know as well as I do, Rosalind, in Shakespeare, betwixt 17 and 23, there's naught to do save getting maids, wenches with child, and wronging the ancientry.
That's just the boys.
Can you let Edward finish his question?
Yes. What I'm trying to drive at is this. Earlier on, you used words like goodness and structures, which make me go for the hills, because it's like eating jelly with a fork. It is a fact, however much we hate it, that we used to have a lot of extremely harsh, sharp-edged authority, and we used to have a great deal less youth crime. Mm. I don't like the harsh authority, but it would have appeared to have worked. Now, if this is so...
Worked, Edward? What's your definition of worked?
Crime figures.
Very
low
crime figures. Do you accept the crime figures uncritically as they're offered to us?
They could be out by 100% and they would still be vastly lower in 1890 than they are today.
I really feel that that is a most unsubtle and unhelpful measure, and that doesn't mean that I don't share everyone's concern about crime. But when you think of, first of all, the number of elements which have come into this, computerization of figures, different structures of reporting. I'm not saying that the amount of violence has not.
But isn't it the generally received view among criminologists that life was particularly ferocious, late 18th, early 19th century, and that then authority began to get a grip on things about 1850?
But that was also a point at which London had the biggest criminal underclass that that city has ever known at the time, when not only was punishment at its most inhumane, but prisons had invented things like instruments of torture, such as treadmills and so on. Mm. I really cannot accept this crude connection between pain and... Let's not get into an argument about crime figures.
Let's talk about general antisocial behaviour, which virtually everybody agrees has increased.
Yes.
The aggressive behaviour. Yes. Now, haven't the structures that used to contain and teach boys to control their aggressive impulses been dismantled over the last 30 years?
Yes, they have, but the problem lies not with that, but the fact that we haven't come up with anything imaginative to put in their place. We've had 25 years of the women's movement where women have been doing an enormous amount of work on themselves, and men have just been shoving their heads into the sand and hoping that it's all going to get better. It's time for everybody to start doing some work on men, above all men.
All right, Rosalind, thanks very much indeed. Our next witness is Professor David Smith, who has the chair of criminology at Edinburgh University. You're obviously an expert in the causes and criminology, particularly yobbery, presumably antisocial behaviour. But
there aren't any experts, but still, go on.
You're the closest we can find. Why is it such a problem? Do you think there's some sort of moral degeneracy in society, or is this due to some external factors like unemployment or poverty or something of that nature?
You're not going to get a simple, straightforward answer from an academic to a question like that, are you, in his own field? But can I just throw a fact at you? I think we should argue about the crime figures, and however you look at it, whether you measure crime by the official statistics of recorded crime or through crime surveys, which are now used widely throughout the Western world and which show broadly similar trends, there was a huge increase in crime in all the Western countries bar one, not just recently, although there has been an increase just recently, but most notably in the period between 1950 and 1975, and that of course was the period of unparalleled economic growth and prosperity throughout the Western world. So the one exception is Japan, where there was no such increase, and indeed crime has gone down in Japan since the Second World War. So I thought it'd be nice to start with the fact.
Right, and the other, is there a link, if we're talking about links, is there a link between sort of heavier, more widespread punishment and crime and antisocial behaviour? Is it something that reduces it?
There are all sorts of paradoxes about punishment, but undoubtedly there is no simple straightforward link between the use, widespread use of serious severe punishment and the amount of crime. If I go back again to my Japanese example, penalties are rather light in Japan, the prison population in Japan is very low compared with ours, and the crime level is also extremely low.
David Cook, you're yes.
Professor Smith, it's quite clear that punishment is confused. Deterrence doesn't seem to work. The idea of trying to reform people doesn't seem to make any difference because people are repeat offenders. So in the end, don't we come down to a view of retribution, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, some notion of desert? And how do you give people what they deserve?
Well, one of the paradoxes about punishment, and you could call it the tragedy of punishment, is that it can't achieve the objectives that people set for it. Of course, punishment does have to be retributive. For one thing, if it's not retributive at all, it means that you can't limit it. Because it's retribution, it means that you can only punish something for somebody, for something that he actually has been proven to do in the past, and you can't treat him with regard to things that you think he might do in the future. And that's an advantage of the retributive principle. But the tragedy of it is that people think that when you punish people, you might improve a situation in some way, and in fact you don't. There's a huge amount of evidence to show that the individual person who is punished is not improved, but is further degraded by the fact of having been punished. The only way that you can justify having punishment at all is by the kind of need that people have, society perhaps as a whole has, to feel that something is being done to recognise the wrong that has been done against somebody, and the way that that helps a sense of social cohesion to be brought about. But you certainly can't justify it in terms of bringing about a result in terms of crime reduction.
So it's the scales of justice trying to restore the balance where the crime is in one part of the scale and then the punishment is the other, and that restores the balance in society? Is that the picture?
The picture is that there's, I think, a primitive need in people, which politicians instinctively recognise, to feel that there will be a formal recognition that somebody has done wrong and for something to be done about that, and that's the need that punishment
needs. We should come clean and just announce that.
I think people recognise it anyway. Yes, certainly we should come clean.
As factual a question as I can give you, we had, until very recently, a short-lived and extremely soft Criminal Justice Act, which, as far as youth offenders were concerned, which meant that they were brought to court, admonished and sent away and came back and were admonished again. We've now had a shift round to much readier and earlier imprisonment of those young offenders. Was that a sensible move?
Not at all. It's not a factual question, of course,
well,
which you said it would be. It's a matter of judgment and analysis what the answer to it is. But I think all the evidence is that that's not a sensible move at all, because there's a huge amount of evidence to show that those individual young people who are going to be locked up, some of them, of course, it's only going to be a tiny proportion of the total that will be locked up, even under the new provisions. But those individual young people who are going to be locked up are going to be degraded as a result and are much more likely to offend as a result.
But what was the use of the old law when all that could happen was the magistrate could wring his hands at them?
The law, as far as individuals are concerned, is not very much use at all.
So
it's not performing that function.
So what do you say to the people, the poor people who are on the receiving end of all this, the people on housing estates whose lives can be made utter miseries for them? If you say the law has no effective function, they have no defender of any sort.
What you have to say to those people is that you have to consider how to reduce crime, which is an entirely different subject from how to punish people more effectively.
But that doesn't really answer the question, does it?
Well, what is the question?
Well, the question is, what message do you convey to people who suffer at the hands of crime about the ability of society or government to cope with it?
Well, on the one hand, you have to have a framework within which some people are punished, and but you have to try and restrict the damage of that, that manifestly does as far as possible. On the other hand, you have to have effective crime reduction policies, and those will largely be policies that tend to prevent the opportunities for crime, in my view.
Janet, the last question.
As you said yourself, punishment doesn't just serve to deter. In fact, it doesn't serve to deter at all, presumably, or very little. What it does do is symbolise society's disapproval of certain kinds of acts, which
yes.
is a very important function, isn't it?
It is extremely important,
and it's
yes.
very important from the point of view of victims and potential victims.
I agree with
it?
That, yeah.
And it's also the case that although people do tend to reoffend when they've been sent to prison, they also tend to reoffend when they're not sent to prison, don't they? People who get community sentences and so on also reoffend.
Oh, yes, but there's good evidence that those who are sent to prison are more likely to reoffend than
because
if they haven't been sent to
prison. Because they've usually committed more serious crimes to begin
no,
with.
No, there's good evidence that the same person with the same history and the same personal history and history of offending, if sent to prison, will be more likely to reoffend than if he had not been sent to prison.
Professor Smith, thanks very much indeed. Our next witness is Dr. Adrian Rogers, who's director of the Conservative Family Institute. Dr. Rogers, do we actually, I mean, you heard what Professor Smith said, do you take that view, or do you take the view that we do need to actually crack down in some way on yobs?
Of course, most crime is actually a problem of children, and most crime is committed by children, and crime needs to be deterred by tough, unpleasant and speedy punishment.
Does that include corporal punishment, in your view?
It shouldn't at the moment, but we haven't actually tried punishment for the last 10 years for most of these people. They've actually had caution after appearances, and they never actually get to the hard bit of a door being locked in their face in a prison. So most of the figures that we have about success of crime really don't actually apply.
So you would like to see more custodial sentencing, at least, and perhaps corporal punishment as a last resort?
We need to up the level of punishment until it's effective.
Can I ask you the obverse of all this? You presumably think there is too much yobbery. Yobbery is increasing. To what do you ascribe that?
It's due to the breakdown of the family. And that's why you can't just punish. You have to actually fix the family.
Right.
And that's the bigger challenge.
So you're, excuse me for sloganising, but you're tough on crime and tough on the causes of crime, eh?
I am keen to support
that was a cheap,
the family.
That was a cheap point,
thank
I'm afraid.
Cheap when it was said.
Sorry, David Starkey, your witness.
Right. I take what you've said, and in some ways I very much sympathise with it, but let again present you with a fact. The country in the world that imprisons the largest segment of its population is America. America also has what I think, secretly, if you told the truth, you would like, the death penalty. And nevertheless, its figures of criminality make even ours look modest. How does the kind of argument that you've been advancing square with those facts?
Well, this isn't the States, that's the first thing. And I'm quite prepared to be perfectly open and say, of course, I welcome the death penalty. That is something which underwrites the whole of the value of human life, but that's another story. But in this country, one knows what is needed in this country. There is an unprecedented breakdown of the care, especially of young males, between the ages of 13 and the ages of 20. That's the dangerous age, and that's where we need to concentrate our efforts.
Sorry, David, I'll let you go on in a second, but are you saying 13-year-olds ought to be sent to prison or custodial
or hanged?
No, I'm saying 13-year-olds need supervision. And if you take these children and put them before a magistrate's court and you say, bring me the mother and bring me the father, there's usually no father. And that's the reason they behave the way they do.
Sorry, David,
so we're going to ignore any kind of comparison with other countries. We're going to also ignore the expert, the criminologist, Professor Smith, who has just told you that there's very little evidence that punishment actually works. What else are we going to ignore?
We're not going to ignore them.
You're a conservative. I'm a conservative. I'm a libertarian conservative. You're not a libertarian conservative. Do you see any connection between what our government has been doing over the last 10 or so years and these increased levels of criminality or not? Do you think crime has some social and political causes?
Yes, but I don't think we've been dealing with it.
So you
neither
ignore
do I think
all
any...
David, let her finish.
We haven't been punishing children and we haven't been supporting families.
Sorry, I was asking you to think, I was asking you to get off your hobby horse on punishment. I know it's very attractive and that people deeply enjoy it, but I'm asking you to think a little bit more deeply on the questions of the social causes of crime. Do you admit that unemployment is a social cause of crime? Do you admit that changes in our educational system are causes of crime?
David, can you let
me answer? And the evidence shows that they're not. No, because in areas where productivity, where employment went up, crime also went up. That's been shown by Mr. Murray recently in his book. So, you know...
So, just one second. That's absolutely true for the 1950s and the 1960s. It is absolutely untrue for the 1890s to the 1920s. So, just one second. What happened in the 1950s and the 1960s and the early 1970s was a breakdown of certain types of social structures.
I think you're obsessed with history, to be honest. We've got to deal with the problem now
exactly.
In 1990.
Can I just...
Michael,
David, I really will...
Sorry,
quiet,
this is no,
second.
Michael, I will not
David,
have this silly
David,
demolition
please.
Of an idea of history.
David.
History is the only basis on which any human being can think rationally about the present. If you do not know about the past, you cannot think about the present, and you cannot
all
handle
right.
the future.
All right, David,
and
that's
cheap
fine.
Remarks like yours and foolish remarks like his are simply not acceptable.
Thank you very much.
Can
for
I try
confusion.
And
can I just get to one point that I don't quite understand? If you're not ascribing a rise of criminality of this kind to social causes, unemployment, poverty, and so on. Are you merely ascribing it to the fact that we no longer punish particularly young people
no.
the way you would like? Is that the only reason?
Neither am I saying that unemployment doesn't play any role. I'm saying it may a relatively small role. The main cause of crime is the breakdown of family life, the supervision.
But
the
why
care
is family life broken down?
The
Edward,
care
you,
and
Edward,
the control
can,
of children.
Can I please,
does unemployment have nothing
David,
to do with the breakdown of family
quiet,
life?
David, my dear, listen, you quoted Charles Murray a moment ago. Charles Murray believes that unmarried mothers should be starved back into matrimony.
Oh, he doesn't at all.
By not, I'm sorry, this is, by not being paid benefits. And now, do you think that this particularly draconian view is right?
No, but I think he's keen to support, and so would I be, to support marriage. You have to say, hey, how are you going to fix the family? Well, the least you can do as a state, as a government, is to actually encourage people to stay together and raise their children.
Yes, but he's quoted in an interview this morning as agreeing with the proposition that was put to him. You would be willing to starve them out, you would be willing to withhold benefits so that they are induced
no,
to marry.
No, of course not, but I would give increased benefits to married couples. That's vital.
Yes.
The Conservative Party obviously is in favour of the family. I mean, so many government ministers have had so many different ones. Obviously, they're very much in favour. I applaud the desire to go back to family values, but how on earth are we going to do it? What are the actual steps that are going to make the difference?
Let's be truthful. I don't think any political party has been in favour of the family. They've accepted it's there and it's gone on doing its function, when in fact it's broken down over the last 15, 20 years.
So your party hasn't either, then?
It's probably done least to destroy it.
Oh, sorry. I beg your pardon. Hasn't this government, in fact, reinforced the tax and benefit system which discriminates against families and is in favour of single parents? In fact, benefits are higher for single parents than for married couples.
Yes, I agree. So
this government has, in fact, contributed to the destabilising of marriage.
Because it has listened too much to the liberal intellectuals and the left-wing of the country,
But you still have to accept the culpability.
And divorce is easier.
But if you believe that you've got to fix the family, you're certainly not going to ask a socialist or a liberal Democrat.
Oh, I agree. But you still have to accept your responsibilities as a Conservative government that has been
in power
for 15 years.
I'm not in power, but if I was, we would fix the family. Of course.
Dr. Rogers, do you also see any sort of collapse of other things outside politics? We're into politics, we're into history. Do you see a collapse of faith in a morality outside politics?
Yes, because families are held together by law, by taxation, and by this underlying Christian or Judeo-Christian religion that fixed our laws, fixed our behaviour. That's been demolished. The Church of England's done its bit to demolish it part of the time.
God has a crowd control mechanism?
Well, I don't care to some extent what it takes to fix crowds. I mean, I actually do believe in God, and I think that he does fix them.
But you're using a utilitarian argument for God. Not that he's true, but that he's useful.
Because politicians and the public don't listen to any other argument. That's the trouble.
But look, let's take you in your more general position. We can agree we've got this crowd. We watched it from a bus today in Moss Side, two youths trying to kick each other. Charming. We have had a major shift out of a whole cast of mind that existed in the 30s. And fiscal reform and fiscal juggling, however extensive, will not put it back. Are we not talking about a genie that is out of a bottle and about which we can only, as it were, go in mourning?
No, it's never too late to fix. You can begin to re-establish the faith in the country, you can make the changes in taxation and law that support family life, and you can bring in the Tough Punishment Bill Act as a deterrent.
So, as it were, the flag, the rod and the gyro check.
If you like.
And
if it works.
That is crowd control. That is yob culture control.
If it protects kids, all you've got to do is look after boys in those dangerous ages, and you've solved most of this country's crime problem.
Dr. Rogers, thank you very much indeed.
Thanks a lot.
Last witness is Alan Corkish, who's a teacher, but back in the 60s was actually living in the Isle of Man as a very young man, and was birched for fighting, I think. Did it do you good?
No. You wouldn't expect it to, would you?
Well, I don't know. I'm asking you.
Well, what happens is you become degraded by being beaten by somebody. And if you're degraded, you want revenge. You tend to fight back.
So what happened to you?
That's what I did.
So what happened to you after that?
Well, I went back to my peer group and became a hero. And got into a lot more trouble afterwards than I had before.
A lot of trouble?
Yes. 50 times.
50 times what?
Involved in court cases for fighting, disturbing the peace, carrying offensive weapons.
And you think you wouldn't have done that if you had been treated less corporally?
It's hard to tell in retrospect, but I know that it contributed to it, that my being beaten gave me a medal with my friends when I went back.
You broke away physically from the island and emotionally from your past, and you became a teacher. Do you not think from that totally different perspective that the pendulum has gone too far, that there are lots of teachers who are saying, actually, because of the law, because of the pressures of officialdom and authority, we can no longer have the wherewithal to maintain discipline with children the ages Dr. Rogers was talking about, 13, 14, 15?
I think the only discipline that matters is discipline that comes within yourself. And
that can't be true, can it?
Why? Why can't it?
Well, if we're relying on self-discipline for order in society, we're finished, aren't we?
Well, what people tend to mean when they say discipline is inflicting pain or inflicting their ideas on somebody. And self-discipline comes from respect for yourself.
Edward, your witness.
Mr. Corkish, I wouldn't for a moment advocate that anyone should suffer what you suffered, but given the fact of people offending and breaking the law and breaking it habitually and again, you wouldn't quarrel with the idea that something ought to be done, that some people may have to go to places where they're locked up for a bit, people may be sent away and put aside for a little while? Does that strike you as degrading in the same way as flogging?
I think that it's a corny old saying, but it's true. You catch more flies with honey than with vinegar.
Well, there used to be a thing in the middle, Mr. Corkish, which was called Borstal. And Borstal was not a barbarous thing. It was a sort of industrial training school. You went there and you learned certain trades. They were a bit primitive and they could have been sophisticated infinitely beyond what they did. But they weren't without use, were they?
Well, most of the people who I knew who were involved in crime, fighting, that sort of thing, were people who came from a certain type of background.
Yes.
And they always felt that society was not for them anyway. What worked with me was getting an education given to me by society later on in my life, which gave me some self-respect.
So you say a certain background, you're talking about relative poverty, right?
Yes.
Did you come from relative poverty?
Severe poverty.
Right. What distinguishes people who go through severe poverty and do commit crimes and they become habitual criminals, and those who come from that and don't?
People find their self-respect from different places. I found mine in education. I had no idea of who I was when I was a child, no idea of my identity, until the society I was in came to recognize me, if you
that's
like.
That's fascinating. Can you just make it a little bit narrower for us? When and how did you begin to gel into an identity? Can you place it?
When society actually gave me access to something which interested me, and which made
study,
me appreciate
words, a study course,
that I was
words.
Of some worth. Yes.
A study course.
Yes.
So, exactly, you had something to do, you bit upon it, it interested you, and it lit your mind.
Yes.
But, all right, clearly this would work for a lot of people, for a big piece of the margin, but it wouldn't be a universal panacea, would it? It wouldn't apply for everybody.
I don't see why it wouldn't apply to anybody, if you like, in terms of simply giving them self-respect.
Okay. What did you make of Dr. Rogers? What's wrong with his idea, particularly, that you really ought to be tougher, particularly, presumably, on children the age you were when you got belted in the Isle of Man?
Because if you're tough on somebody in a physical way, they react. If I smack you in the mouth now, you'll smack me back, I suspect, won't you? I mean,
well,
that's how people react. When they birched me, when I realised I was living in abject poverty, I kicked against that.
Yeah.
When I got punished by society, I kicked harder. If they hurt me, I'll hurt them back. That was what I thought then.
But let me push it to absurd lengths. I'm not sure I quite went along with the professor when he sort of said, well, you know, there's no relationship between punishment and reduction in crime. If I thought that by slashing tyres I'd have my hands cut off, I might, you know, there might be a significant portion of people who might think twice about slashing tyres.
Take it to its extreme, give them the death penalty. It becomes a silly argument, doesn't it?
David?
Well, let's take this silly argument a bit further, because there are countries that cut people's hands off,
yes,
like Saudi Arabia. And the problem with Michael is very simple, isn't it? Why is Saudi Arabia a society with quite low crime rates?
Because...
Is it because of the punishment?
I think it's a fear of punishment. If I thought I was going to get my hands cut off for not doing the right thing...
You've now conceded Michael's point. The reason is surely quite different. It's because Saudi Arabia is a society structured according to certain sets of values that makes it acceptable to cut people's hands off. Ours is not such a society. The problem that we have is that we have to deal with the contradiction between freedom and order. And nothing whatever that we've said round this table, or frankly, that any witness has said to us, has got us one jot further down that road.
Janet.
Isn't it the case that a great many people who are part of what the Prime Minister calls the yob culture are not actually poor at all? That a great many football hooligans, for example, are in fact in employment and earning good money, as they say. Isn't it a bit of an insult to the poor to say that poverty is an inevitable cause of crime and antisocial behaviour? It's quite capable. Your people who are poor and unemployed are quite capable of self-respect.
What I'm
saying is that there's a danger in equating poverty with the causes of crime, isn't there? And
yes.
Unemployment with the causes of crime.
Yes.
Would you agree, as a teacher, that young males particularly need structure and constraint, and that perhaps the permissive child rearing and the progressive schooling that has been so fashionable for the past 30 years has gone a long way to dismantle those very structures which allow children to learn self-discipline and self-control?
Well, I didn't see much evidence for this progressive attitude, actually.
In the Isle of Man? No, I dare say not.
In Liverpool, where I've been teaching in Liverpool,
yeah.
I've seen kids getting beaten on a regular basis up till a few years ago. And what you would see, yes, in state schools, it's only been abolished for 5 years. Yeah. When you see a kid's name in the punishment book and you look back, it's the same kid every time that comes forward. It doesn't work. Punishing doesn't work.
David Cooker, last question.
Education transformed you, yet there's more violence against teachers who are trying to give that educational opportunity. So how, as a teacher, do you respond to violence and yobbery in the classroom?
Well, again, I didn't see much evidence for that. I didn't see much. I never had any violence directed at me.
Many of your colleagues do constantly.
Well,
complain.
I'm going to get shot for this, but lots of my colleagues perhaps bring it upon themselves because they deserve
How?
It.
So
it's because
the
of their attitude it's towards
the victim,
children.
Then, not the
no.
offender.
You're saying
who's
they're
the problem.
Arrogant towards children.
If
is that what you're saying?
Some teachers are very arrogant towards children. There's a case going on in Liverpool this very minute where there's a child being thrown out of the classroom for wearing earrings. Now, that's conflict that the teachers have brought about. What on earth are they doing? Why are they so stupid that they can't respect
it's
the children?
It's obviously something that, that teachers and children and the local authorities themselves feel very strongly about. Mr. Corbish, thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Janet, could we just draw this down to these sort of central questions that we started off with? Who are the yobs? Why are they yobs? What could be done about it?
Yeah, well, the two questions, those last two questions of yours, seems to me have been confounded all the way through the discussion. Why do they exist, if indeed there is a yob culture? Why does it exist? And what do we do about it? They're two very separate questions.
Right.
But I think they're not unrelated. My own view is that the structure, the meaning of authority and discipline has been so dismantled over the past 30 years, particularly since the 60s, in education and in parenting styles, that the confidence that people have in an unequivocal sense of right and wrong has been dismantled, and that children growing up in such an environment are made pathologically insecure, and that is what we're seeing around us.
It's a depressing picture.
Look, I was immensely taken with Mr. Corbish, and I think he said some very important things, and what he said about being able to bite upon education and be recognised as a human being is enormously important, and it's constructive. It doesn't have universal application, it is not the total answer, but it is clearly part of the answer, it's important. I was as bitterly disappointed with Professor Smith, who I thought was an apostle of the worst sort of academic complacency, saying to people on housing estates being beaten up, well, that is how it is, we can't do anything about it, but here are a few more academic meaningless words. We have got to have a measure of punishment. It should not be barbarous because barbarity is wrong, period. But if you have sensible increments and you're willing to catch a young offender and hold him for a bit and hold him in quite tough terms, if you've got a recidivist and you hold him in quite gentle terms but for a long time so he doesn't make a nuisance to anybody else, both halves of that make a certain amount of sense. And if we could start with those two things, plus Mr. Corkish's interest in education, we might get somewhere.
There's a determinism about all of this. The two separate elements. There's what's the cause of this and what's the cure. The difficulty when we've looked at the different witnesses, the causes are sometimes supposed to be nature and sometimes it's totally environment. And I haven't had that balance between the both end. And the cure has to take both seriously. And again, the witnesses I felt were disappointing. I'd like to go with Ed and say, oh, it's fine, let's educate people, but it's not as easy as that. And what are we going to do with the people who don't fit into the educational process?
I
in the end...
I don't quite mean educate, David. I mean find the thing which bites for them, as education did for him. It might be something else,
right, but
for it's activity.
For people for whom it doesn't bite, it never bites. In the end, I think we have to come back to what Professor Smith had to say. There is an inevitable retributive base which the society
which
needs.
Which he rejects.
Which
has.
But, no, David, accepting it.
But David, did you also with me think that it might not be the way forward, but to actually say there is no link between punishment and the suppression of crime, did not seem to... He might have the statistics to back it up, but it didn't seem reasonable.
No, I think he's basically right. In the sort of society in which we are, in a society like Japan or Saudi Arabia, there is such a link, because punishment has meaning. The whole point of being a yob is that punishment has no meaning to you at all. There's no moral framework. No, Edward, just one second. There's no moral meaning through which the punishment can actually purchase upon you. But I fear Professor Smith was not being a foolish academic. Professor Smith was only saying what you'd done at the beginning of the programme, that any politician who touches this area is a fool. Because basically there is very little of substance that can be done. It's not simply a question of putting back structures of authority. It is reinventing a whole past world that also involves reinventing a past economy. It involves jobs for people who are unskilled. It involves jobs that will actually deal with a male of rather sub-average intelligence and give him purpose and something to do. And I can see no way at all in which the sort of society that we have or are likely to have, even under the sainted Mr. Blair, is going to do any of those things at all.
It's Janet. True that there's very little that government can do in a constructive sense once it's got to this point, but there's a hell of a lot they can do that's wrong, that's in a negative sense. They can dismantle...
They can exacerbate further.
They can exacerbate
But we're talking about trying to improve.
Hang on, by dismantling structures which ordinary people, given their own sort of instincts and moral intuitions, would happily maintain. The government can actively dismantle those and undermine them, and that's what governments have been doing for the last 30 years.
You use the example of the family, but you left out the prime reason for family breakdown in the working classes. It is that there are not working class male jobs that suffice to keep the family
and
going.
And there's a benefit structure which actually offers an incentive to people...
But the benefit structure is only the icing on the cake. The substance, the cake, is the absence of unskilled male employment.
David, thanks very much. That's it for this week from our panel, Janet Daly, David Cook, Edward Pearce and David Starkey. Highest form of new yobbery indeed. Good night.